all in a life, man. Go on with it, go on with it.
Yeah, is it?
Are you kidding me? Okay. Force, yeah. So we are coming with a force, yeah. Blessings we are reap and we coursing on. Oh, we not rise and boast. Yeah, we give thanks that we need it the most. We have to give thanks that we really supposed to be thankful. Blessings all for my life and my thank God for the journey to earn it.
Yeah, that's right.
4, 3, 2, 1.
You're now tuned into Arts and Rhymes Radio. 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 Radio.
Having us, we're all in. We're gonna get this started again. We're gonna run it from the top. King P.I.B. This is called Pray.
This was a set.
If you can hear, make sure you drop a fire emoji, please.
Yeah. Have you ever seen death in your eyes, homie? I seen before. I seen my pops dying slow on the back of floor. They fucked my heart up when I seen it up and close. Thinking who am I having my corner when it's getting cold. Smoking on this coach, Jackson guy, wild me. He the only one who I can ask and who can tell me what I need. It's kind of difficult living this life. I seen my mama crying multiple times. I had to get it right. 3 jobs and my uncle taking care of us. She barely lacking, get this money, pay the bills enough. It's real life, always playing this game. It's chess moves and make you win if you play it the same.
Have you ever seen this life? Through the struggle, we gon' fight. Cause I got all these demons fucking with my head.
Day.
Yeah. I say, every day I pray. Hey, I've been trying to wait. Got no much to say. Hey, this one for my makeup. Blood don't make you fit. No, no, you can't relate. This one for my men. Hey, my brother on the street.
Have you ever seen this life?
Whoa, I'm 26, living life I'm not supposed to, nigga. Not the type to talk about it, I could show you, nigga. Went from sleeping on the trains and in the phone booth, nigga. Been around the...
All right, King P.I.B., that's King P.I.B. Shout out to King P.I.B., man. We got, due to the technical difficulties, we got just another 3 minutes. So we're going to get an, I think we're going to be one record shy of picking. But we're going to spice it up. Let's do this. Let's do this. Let's do this. Let's make this quick. Shout out to everybody that's tuned in. Again, if you tuned in live, this is the Sound of Business Music. Well, not music, Artist Development Panel. We're here today with a bunch of very, very, very heavily decorated guests. Super honored to be here. Shout out to our sponsors, Arts and Rhymes, the SOBs NYC, the legendary SOB. Shout out to Raquel for putting this all together, man. Thank you for having me. It's lit, man. So we're gonna pick another one here. Let's see here. Let's see here. Who we got here? Let's play it one more time. Who we got in the chat? Who we got in the chat? Shout out to you guys for joining. Prototype. Let's click it here. Okay, Prototype, you didn't include your SoundCloud or your Spotify link. So, we have to pick somebody else. Okay, Somebody here with the SoundCloud link. Who is this here? Prince from the 8. Prince from the 8. If you in the chat, what's up? Make some noise. Prince from the 8. If you in the chat, make some noise. Prince from the 8. If you are in the chat, make some noise. This one is called Prince A-Class. Prince featuring Keys. Not sure where you from, brother, but I hope you in the chat. I hope you in the chat. We tuned in right now. Let's go.
Hello?
Thought it was my phone.
They never told me. They never told me that you.
Okay, this is.
They never told me. Girl, I can't lie, I'm in love.
Okay, we're gonna stop that one, Prince, because you didn't have that one mix. So what we're gonna do is, if you're in this chat, DM me, please. DM me. We're gonna get your song mixed. It's on me. So we're gonna choose one more really quick. It's about to be 7:30, guys. So our panelists are about to be locked in with me. So I'm going to get one more song in. Prince, if you are in the chat, please DM me. We're going to free mix on me, man. We're going to get your song mixed. Let me see here. Let's see here.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, hold on, let me start my video. Okay, can you see me?
Cool. Yeah, you're good. You're good. We're on live right now. I'm about to just play one more record. Let's see. You just stand by. We're on live with the people. Okay, some of you guys didn't include the links, but it's all good.
Do I look pixelated?
Nah, you good.
Okay.
It'll be on the broadcasting side. All right, well, our panelists are in. Is everybody in? Do we have everyone in? Once everyone is in, we're going to pivot. For everybody that's tuned into the Instagram live,
What's good? JB is in here. What's good?
Yo, I'm in Red South Studio right now. Shout out to my boys, man. It's 350 in here tuned in for showing me love. We're going to make sure all the panelists are in. Let me check participants. Cool. I think we are all in. Can everyone hear me?
I can hear you.
Everyone.
Yeah. Naveed.
Yo.
What's good?
Hi, Naveed.
What's good, everybody? We are live on SOB's NYC Instagram Live. Thank you guys for tuning in. This is the Sounds of Business Artist Development Panel. I carefully handpicked each of you individuals because you guys are heavyweights in the game, doing your thing, helping change the lives of so many. You guys have done so many epic things, and there's so many ambitious and hungry artists in the chat tonight, and I definitely want to be able to impart some wisdom on all of the artists that are in the chat. So we have some really dope questions. We're going to go into it. Also, in light of everything that's been going on, we just want to touch a little bit on how we can increase diversity within the community and provide more equal opportunities for everyone, because creativity comes from all different walks of life and from so many different sources. And so again, thank you all for coming into the chat. I appreciate you again. So we're going to start with intros first. And since I guess right under the square here, we're going to start with Pop, my guy Pop. I've known him for quite some time. He's one of the original designers for the Rap Snacks brand. Thank you guys for tuning in. I wish we had the round of applause sound. But we won't. So we'll go one at a time instead. And yeah, let's do it.
Oh man, appreciate you for having me. I guess by nature, I'm a creative artist, visual artist, painter, designer. Do a lot of different, you know, disciplines. Work with a lot of different companies on like product development, brand development. My strong, you know, suit is like more like project development or whatever, or just project management in general. It doesn't really necessarily matter like what type of product it is. It's just, you know, looking at the vision and looking at the overall purpose behind the brand is the most important thing. So, you know, that's kind of like my, you know, quick 1-2 as far as, you know, who
humble.
I am.
Humble, yeah. humble. But we'll get to it though. We'll get to it though, because, you know, we got a lot of panelists here to speak to. So next we'll start with, we'll go with Portia. What's up, Portia? Marie in the building.
Hey, guys.
What's up? Introduce yourself to the people.
Why you can't introduce me?
I want you to tell the people all of the amazing things that you've done, Queen. Let them know.
Okay, guys. So I am the CEO and founder of the PM Firm and Dope People Meet. The PM Firm is a boutique entertainment marketing company based out of Atlanta, Georgia. So it consists of PR, entertainment marketing, etc., talent management, the list goes on, okay? Then also we have Dope People Meet. It's an event curation platform that consists of webinars, premiere parties, live events, physical events, and that's what we do. We connect creators all across the world. We are a global brand, so we are a full powerhouse. Everything is powered by the PM Firm, so that's a little bit. It's a lot, but you can check us out at the website. Go to dopepeoplemeet.com. Go to pmfirminc.com. Everything we have done is up to date, so you will see everything that we have done.
Got it. Thank you. All right, we got Sarah up next. Sarah.
Hi. My name, I like the shades, by the way. Very cool.
God bless. Thank you. It's a nice touch.
My name is Sarah Gilbert. I head the marketing and communications for a wine and spirits company called Sovereign Brands. Our current portfolio is Luc Belair. You may know the bubbly, kind of popularized by our black bottle rosé. We have a rum called Bamboo, which Lil Wayne right now is championing, and a gin. That's our new brand called McQueen and the Violet Fog. It's taking off. It's awesome. We have a bunch of brands in the works, but I think where my job description is relevant to this conversation, I oversee our artist partnerships. So a lot of our marketing collabs, whether it's wearables, like I'm wearing now, or brand ambassador relationships. We also have a New York office where it's kind of like a media stop now. JB and I have collabed, Naveed and I have collabed a lot on that. And so our company has quite an extensive media arm now. So there's a lot of cool original content we're doing as well. So
awesome. Yeah, that's the humble side for you too. But it's all good. We're gonna continue on. We'll get to it. Next up we got Naveed. Ooh, I'm just trying to see the square here. Naveed.
Yo, I've seen Genius pop in the background.
Yeah, you saw Genius pop in, right?
Cool. I'm Navita. I'm an artist manager at a firm in LA called EDM. We work with all genres of artists, indie and. I do a lot of development, artist development myself, and I kind of run the A&R division of the company as well. So happy to be here.
Okay, awesome. Thank you for hold up 2 seconds. We're gonna pause. I see somebody in the chat saying they can't hear. We got IT on the line as well. IT, if you could just check the chat to see, they're saying there's no sound.
Give me 1 second.
Don't make us do that again.
Thank everybody. I just want to speak to the panelists really quick. Thank you guys all for coming and tuning in. I appreciate you guys for your time. I know it's super hectic with the alternate schedules and everything going on. So I know everybody's schedules a little flip-flop, you know. Things are a little crazy, but thank you for tuning in. And, you know, we're going to try to help out people. Let's see. Everybody, if you're in the chat and you
JB,
can hear us now. Yes,
I'm
going to
sign. I mean, they're saying there's no sound. I don't hear no sound coming through either. I'm going to sign us out of the lodge and go right back in. Give me 2 seconds.
Okay.
You
all right.
Guys,
so
can stay, you guys can stay in the zone, though.
Yeah. Well, what's up, guys? We're back live and direct. Sounds of Business Artist Development Music Panel. Thank you guys for tuning in. SOBs NYC. We're live with all of our guests. We were in the middle of introducing our panelists. And so we had just finished with Sarah of Sovereign Brands. And so we're going to go with Mike. Mike Hamilton is in the building.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Mike Hamilton. I'm Director of Commerce and Epic Records. All of our streaming partnership programming playlist.
Somebody has to mute their, sorry, Mike, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Somebody has to mute their playback. We're getting the feedback. All right, I think you're good to go now, Mike.
So I oversee all of the DSP partnerships at Epic on the R&B and hip hop side. So I work with Giveon, Future, Nicki Minaj, 21 Savage, Travis Scott. Before this, I was at Atlantic doing the same role, dealing with music, Pandora title. So essentially, everything with an artist rollout on the streaming services that all funnel through me.
All right, all right. And then we have Chameleon in the building.
What's up?
What's up? What's up? Let the people know what's going on.
What's up? It's Chameleon, the rawest bitch in the world. Straight out of Florida. Straight out of Florida. Yeah. Independent artist. Some of you may know, some of you may know my song that I had called Twerk For Me that really, really did well. And it allowed me to go on a world tour. I toured Europe, US in 2019 up until the Rona hit. And yeah, I'm here, you know what I'm saying, to talk about music and whatever the fuck else we're gonna talk about. That's what it is.
Yeah, so thank you all for tuning in. Let's check in now with the fans, make sure everybody can hear. If you guys can hear, please drop something in the chat to let us know, just so we're clear. I think we're gonna be cool. I think we're cool. So now that we've done the introductions, I thank you guys again. Shout out to our sponsors one last time, Arch and Rhymes, SOB NYC, and Gold 38 for making this all happen, as well as Bag Management, my company, shameless plug. Okay, before I get started, it's just somebody, like their output is just a little too loud, so we're getting the feedback. And that's within the Zoom. So if somebody else has a second phone or something that they're listening on. All right. Well, so we're going to, I guess, basically do like a kind of a round robin. Some questions might get to all the panelists. Some questions might not, just for the sake of time. And I want to make sure that we get to all of them. So just bear with me. But just kind of to get started, we've all basically had a lot of experience when it comes to connecting the dots with partnerships. And so I kind of want to start at the origin of what partnerships mean for companies, so that artists even understand how they would fit into the picture. And I would love to start with Sarah, if you may.
Yeah.
Awesome. So yeah, I just want to let the artists know about what partnerships mean to corporations and why do they do them in the first place, and kind of just the differentiation between the paid and the unpaid, because, you know, artists think every partnership is paid, which is not the truth.
Sure. Partnerships are on all levels, and our philosophy as a business, and hopefully for most brands, is we want to support your supporters. Really wrong when a company will launch a brand kind of assuming who their core demo is. So I think it's important to release something and pay attention to who's consuming it, who's wearing it or repping it proudly. And those are the types of people that a brand should be going after for a collaboration/partnership. For us, it has to make sense. It has to start organic. We will fund, I'm speaking to our brands, which are alcohol brands. You drink to celebrate, and so I would say we try to tie into what talent is doing as much as possible. So if we see an artist really reps and supports and is just even open to coming to the table, we'll invite them to our office. We'll hear what you have going on. We like to hear about your rollout. We like to hear outside of music what you're into. and how, you know, aligning with a brand can be part of, furthering your reputation and identity for your own personal career goals. And so we do everything from seeding and sending you product all the way up to, you know, paid partnerships. But everything that we've ever done, any celebrity you've seen rep our brands has always started organically.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Thank you for that answer. I'd like for Pop to answer the question next, being that he, kind of kicked off the designs for Rap Snacks, which is pretty epic. I think that was a really, really big move for the culture. Simply having music represented within, the bodegas and corner stores that are so deeply infused into all of our neighborhoods, especially the lead demo for hip hop as a whole. So just kind of get into a little bit about what partnerships meant to, Rap Snacks when they came to you and like they were just like, hey, we need these designs.
Yeah, so, it's funny because when I originally started working with Rap Snacks, I think somebody their phone is sitting on something and it's vibrating, the sound is vibrating stuff. Your phone is sitting on something, it's vibrating. You might want to pick it up. But I hate hearing myself talk. But so basically when I first started learning about Rap Snacks, it was I didn't even realize that it was a 25-year-old company. And so when James Lindsay, the founder, came to my office and we kind of started talking about different things that they had done in the past, I immediately started referencing retro, just imagery or whatever. And basically from there, he kind of started telling me the vision for just overall messaging of the brand and how he wanted to partner different flavors with the artists, as far as he felt that the actual flavors fit with the personality of the artist or whatever. And the whole case, I think, that really made the...
Hey, Pop, pause one second. I'm sorry, one second. Chameleon, do you have a second phone near the speaker? Does anyone have a second phone that they're tuned in on? No one else? Because I can't really.
Just mute if you're not speaking. Just mute your.
Yeah. If you aren't speaking, then just mute. Yeah.
Yes, that would be the best. But
okay. All right. Go ahead, Pop. I think we might be good.
Yeah. Mic check. Yes. Thank God. Oh my God. So basically, Once we figured out exactly which artists that we're gonna partner with the flavors, we kind of basically jump right in as far as just developing the overall look of the packaging, and most of every little element or whatever we kind of thought out as far as just whenever it came to partnering or matching the flavors with the actual artist, and also just the coloring, the colors, the message that each artist wanted to actually leave behind, as far as everything kind of meshed as far as just say for instance, there were little quotes or whatever. Each artist had a quote that they wanted to kind of leave behind, as far as if you pick up the package or whatever, or you picked up the product at the store, they wanted to basically be able to be the packaging to be an extension of the artist and how the artist communicates on a day-to-day basis and their overall little purpose or whatever. So every meticulous, item was thought out and planned out, even down to the QR code. The QR codes were a direct, communication from with each artist. So you'll be able to like basically scan the bag, and each artist would be, you know, their product or their new song or their, you know, website or whatever product that they were actually promoting at the time, you know, that kind of, you know, was extended, you know, as far as that goes too. So like every little item, you know, was kind of like thought out, and, you know, that was, you know, just the overall message, you know, that we were pushing with each individual bag.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Thank you guys kind of for starting the conversation about brand partnerships. I kind of want to switch now to the side of the artist representation side and how it's important to initiate the conversation, and how much of that equity, that sweat equity, is the manager and how much of it is the artist. So I'd love to start with Naveed, then we're going to go to Portia, and then we're going to go to Chameleon to speak on the artist side.
For artists, man, I really think that, you know, like art, I think that everything the artist does, like, it really needs to flow from the artist, right? Like, I think that, like, fans and, you know, the world is pretty smart, and people can tell when things don't feel like they're authentic. They can feel like, you know, when an artist reps something, that they can tell, like, oh, they don't use that product, or they don't, you know. I think that really kind of, like, it shines through, and I think that we're in an age where sometimes a quick check, you know, while that might be the goal, sometimes you know, kind of need to think more long term. Like, is it worth taking a, you know, a small check to promote a flat tummy tee versus where do I want to go? Do I want to partner with a Nike or with a, you know, a household name brand? So what I advise my clients is just, like, you know, support the products and rep the things that you really use and invest in. Tag them thoughtfully when you're using these products. You don't got to go crazy, but just kind of letting them know, kind of like what Sarah had mentioned, like if you drink, you know, Sovereign Brands liquor, you should let them know, because they might not have any idea, and then they kind of see that you're supporting them, and it kind of starts the conversation, and it comes from a more organic place to begin. I think a lot of times people think there's like a magic wand, or that, you know, you just need a manager, an agent to pitch you for something, when it's not necessary. And you don't need to be the biggest artist in the world to do a brand deal. There's plenty of data that shows that, like, you know, smaller artists can have meaningful relationships with brands. It's more about authenticity. So I just say, like, you know, focus on that stuff first.
Awesome. 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 Portia?
Can you run me the question one more time, JB?
Yeah, so we were just briefly running over the importance, more or less, of brand partnerships from the representative side for artists and for the artist side, really, and then how much of that is attributed to the management and how much of that is attributed to the artist itself.
Okay, well, I have done a lot of brand partnerships in the space of event curation. So if you don't mind, if I can speak from that space for, yeah, you know, those out there. So for me, I'm very strategic about who I bring on as a partner. And at the end of the day, it's all about putting creators in the room to meet other creators that they felt like they would never have been able to meet, like executives or other entrepreneurs or creators in their same space. So basically for me, like, for example, I did a event series with Google. So I first targeted the photography side of it. So I did Dope People Meet, presents we did the streaming economy, which was like all the major platforms like Spotify, Pandora, United Masters, StreamCut, and the list goes on. And we did the attention economy with the photographers, and then we went to New York, and we also did the streaming economy again. We did it during A3C. So for me, it was all about putting the right people in the space for these artists or these creators or these executives to meet these important people, because a lot of times artists are trying to figure out, how do I get paid, or how do I land a placement on your playlist? How does that happen? So now I'm putting you in a space where you can meet them face to face, get a real-time interaction with them, and really get to fill in the space and build your own relationship outside of trying to reach them on social media or trying to email them out of a million emails, you know. So I'm basically putting you in the space where you can meet these people on your own and go do your own partnership. So I'm just very strategic when it comes to that space of partnerships and making sure it makes sense for my brand. But to be honest, dope people meet can meet anybody. So it's no limitations to who we meet. This is a space for creators. This is where creators meet. So we can go meet Google. We can go meet JB. We can go meet the animals at Animal Planet. Like, who cares? Like, we go meet wherever. We just put people in the space to meet other creators and other entrepreneurs, other executives, and people that they feel like they can't physically touch or listen or talk to. So that's like our goal when it comes to partnerships, making sure it makes sense for our audience and making sure they're getting something out of the experience.
Awesome. Awesome. Chameleon, can you tell us how important it is to partner with brands, you know, especially when you're picking up steam as an independent artist on the come up?
Yeah. I like to piggyback off of what the dude before she spoke. Like, for me, like if someone offers me the opportunity to promote their product, you know, in exchange for whatever it is, like, it's hard for me to promote stuff that I don't use. You know what I'm saying? Like, it has to be something that I really, really believe in. You know, like, the check is really not that important for me. You know what I'm saying? Because I feel like I got to keep it 100 with my following, with my fan base, and with myself. You know what I'm saying? And to me, like, when any kind of big brand comes to, like, you know, ask to support an independent artist, you know, it's really an opportunity to show, like, your grind is paying off. You know what I'm saying? It allows, like, your fans to feel like, okay, well, we've been supporting her. Let's take her all the way. Like, now she's picking up steam. She getting, you know, major brands to, you know, be interested in what she got going on. You know what I'm saying? And it's also another opportunity for a lot of independent artists just to stay independent. You know, for myself, like, you know, I make my money from my fans. My fans, they pay my bills. You know what I'm saying? Me going on tour, them streaming my music and everything like that. And to me, it's important for me to own myself. You know what I'm saying? Even if I eventually did a deal, you know, I would want it to be something that would be fair. But in the meantime, when you sponsored by any type of brand, it just allows you financial flexibility, you know what I'm saying, to continue to invest in your music. And y'all cross promote, you know what I'm saying? They tap into a whole different demographic, and you do as well.
Awesome. So now this is going to be directed towards Mike, who's our label representative in the chat currently. Oftentimes it is a battle between label and indie when it comes to figuring out what's the perfect balance to create a deal. Tell me how important it is for an artist to have somewhat of a resume of past brand partnerships. Does that make it more appealing to sign an artist, or does it matter if they start with a clean slate?
I mean, I think it varies. I mean, I to speak frankly, I'm not an A&R, so I'm not in the process of signing the artist, but I do think that having sat in meetings at two different labels and seeing, you know, some of the process or behind artists getting signed, it's not really about any combination of those things. I don't think that, you know, you have to come in with a ton of brand partnerships under your belt. You have to come in with, you know, a certain amount of followers under your belt. I mean, people, obviously labels are looking at that information. That's not to discount it and say it's not important, because it is, but I think really it's really comes down to, is the artist and the company a good fit, one? And then secondly, too, before artists, you know, sign deals with anybody, be it a label, a distributor, anything like that, I think it's really incumbent upon the artist and the management and that team to figure out what is that, well, you know, what is the overall goal for that artist, you know, because there's a lot of conversation these days about, you know, should artists sign a label deal? Should artists go the indie route? Like, it really, you know, which situation makes the most sense. It really comes down to the artists and what their goals are.
Awesome. So I want to speak, a lot of artists wanted to ask the question of when is it appropriate to get representation. So we're going to speak from two standpoints. Obviously, I think that Naveed, we should speak with you first, and then we'll go with Portia because she says she's on talent rep side. And then we're going to go back to the brand partnership side and speak from creative as well as the anchoring the whole deal with Pop and Sarah, just from the standpoint of how important it is to deal with artists who have representation, or speak on an instance where you've like basically done something epic with an artist with artists without representation. So we'll start with Naveed first.
Cool. I mean, the representation thing is a little bit tricky. I think, you know, we're humans, right? Humans win in groups. So, you know, whatever you do, you're going to go farther when you collaborate with people. Does that mean that you should, if you're, you know, a new artist trying to, you know, get on the map, should you spend time like chasing managers and agents and stuff like that? I don't think so. I think you should like focus on your craft, put in that 10,000 hours and really make your product like really stand for, you know, what you believe in, make the music the best it can be and put it out there and work your move best you can. And people will start to notice. And I think that, yeah, the chasing the managers thing isn't really like what, you know, what's going to set you apart. It's I think it's important in this day and age too, for artists to kind of learn every step of the business. Right. So you should kind of know what your manager is doing or what an agent is doing. So when you have experience dealing with, whether it's the booker at SOBs or, getting your music on DSPs, when you kind of understand what these processes are, it will only help you down the line when there's speed bumps or whatever. But above all, it's like, you know, the music comes first. Focus on that, make the music great. Build a fan base, support it, you know, interact with people. And it doesn't have to be, you know, people get stuck on, you know, I need Spotify playlists or I need this or I need that. Like, none of that is
right.
Like what Mike said, like labels do look at numbers and things like that, obviously, but that is not, you know, I've had artists get signed to majors with a few thousand followers. I've had artists with a million followers get turned away for deal. It just really matter. It's really just about have a strong aesthetic and have a message, be unique, and then find the right thing that fits you, whether it's a, you know, an independent route or dealing with a major or something in between. There's no, like, you know, there's no magic wand. There's no one person isn't going to change your career and turn you into a superstar. It's really it's on the artist, and it's on the laps that you do over and over. And if you go back and study the artists that you look up to, I promise you'll find that, you know, you'll find that guys like T.I. were involved in Travis Scott before Travis Scott became what he is, or, you know, and on and on and on, and Meek Mill. And now those guys are doing that with other artists. And so it's just, it's a community, and those guys get noticed because they really worked on their craft for a long time. But it feels short, you know, when you see something explode, you know, over 6 months, it feels like, you know, it just happened, but, you know, we all know that it takes a lot longer than that. So, you know, just stay focused on what you do and on your craft.
All right. Now, getting to Sarah, I see people in the chat. Some people are saying the quality is still messed up, but it's all good. You guys will be able to see this post production and everything like that. Starting with Sarah, I guess, speak on an experience. First, I guess, what it is like to deal with an artist without representation when it comes to anchoring these kind of deals, or maybe speak on an experience where you've handled like a really epic situation and the artist didn't have representation and it was just like you kind of having your ear to the streets, you know what I'm saying, and understanding like, yeah, this is the future and this makes sense for the brand, like let's go with this.
Sure. You know, I think I'd say it's about 50-50, my interactions or meeting talent, 50-50 split between talent reaching out directly or they catch my ear and I hit them directly. I mean, fortunately, we're in an era where accessibility, it's through Instagram and social media, we're very accessible, and I appreciate that. I think whatever gets the job done sooner, I've worked with really, you know, famous management teams who sometimes overcomplicate things, kind of block the collaboration, the flow of ideas with the talent. A lot of times I'll run into the talent and I'll bring up an idea that we had for collaboration and they never heard about it, but they would have. You know what I'm saying? I really appreciate when artists are scrappy and independent and they don't wait, and they reach out to get their career going, and they're pretty open to ideas, and ways to support and get a relationship going in that really organic way. So there have been a lot of success. I'll shout out, like, you know, a 5EL Foreign early on before his deal. He came to the table, I think. He pulled up to the office solo or with Bless, I think, at the time was our first meeting because mm-hmm. Belair was in his Big Drip video.
That's dope. Yeah, I feel like I feel like you was on all the lit artists early. Facts.
And then we stayed in touch. And then he had a rollout coming. So, you know, let's get some photos. Let's shoot some interview content. So he had it for the PR around his project. So he came back up and the relationship is solidifying. We're going to take it a step further and a step further. And, you know, that's over the course of maybe 10 months or so, you know.
Gotcha. Pop, can you speak on a moment where you, you know, I guess created an epic situation based upon the artist without representation, or, you know, speak on the experience of how artists with representation does help a situation, you know, move forward or hinder?
I mean, like, I think, honestly, I like what Sarah was, you know, saying as far as, like, just the organic nature, you know, working with artists, you know, organically, just from, like, networking, you know, out, you know, as far as just, you know, at different events or, you know, maybe just at a random place or whatever. Like, I think, you know, for the most part, any of the relationships that, you know, I have, you know, had, you know, even working with brands, you know, has been, like, more from a space just, you know, because I, you know, naturally, I always, like, look at things from an artist perspective because I'm always, like, I'm an artist first. So I always, like, look at it from a perspective of, like, does this brand even, you know, represent something that I want to, you know, communicate, you know, to my audience? And then also, does their audience have some of those similar synergies? And, you know, I think if you, as an artist, if you always operate from that space, regardless to if you're reaching out to that brand, you know, directly, or if that, you know, relationship has been built organically, I think it's most important to really just, you know, be yourself, like, you know, throughout any of those communications, because a lot of times, you know, I feel like, you know, artists will try to communicate to a brand and kind of like almost overcompensate who they are or some of the things that they've done, you know, from the past or whatever. And I feel like, you know, I always operate from a space that every project is like a new project and every opportunity is a new project to basically, like, you know, relearn some things about yourself and also relearn some things about a company or an organization that may have similar synergies or have similar, you know, audiences as you, but, you know, they may have, you know, a bigger audience or they may have a more diverse audience. And, you know, just always kind of like, you know, be more open to understanding, you know, different messaging that, you know, you may not necessarily, you know, deal with on a day-to-day basis as an individual artist, but also looking at, you know, just the overall, like, message or the overall, like, reach of another company and, you know, just kind of, like, operate from a place of just authenticity or whatever. And, it, you know, you can't really go wrong whenever you're not operating from that space.
Awesome. Yeah, so now moving along, I know that a lot of times in the game, this is another thing that artists spoke on, there's like a fine line when you have the opportunity to speak up for yourself, when you witness or experience something wrong within the industry or somebody possibly blocking your progress and impeding your forward motion. So I'm going to start with Mike and then Chameleon first to speak on, and it possibly, you don't have to get into detail specifics, but just the experience of going through something in the field, and I feel like this is similar because Mike, you being a part of a label in a major corporation, there's a large amount of, I guess, caution that you have to take when speaking on things that you experience in the workplace. And the same thing similarly for Chameleon as an artist on the rise. you know, it's a very fine line that I guess we all you straddle in the sense of, you know, as a career, it being important to, I guess, watch what you say, but also representing someone who empowers other people to speak their mind. Starting with Mike, tell me about an experience that you've gone through in the workplace where you've, you know, basically experienced some hindrance and how you kind of overcame that without feeling like you had to run to the internet or speak out loud and make this big scene, because I think this is important for artists to hear.
Yeah, I love this question. I think this is a great question. It's timely considering, you know, the whole industry Blackout Tuesday and everything that's happened in the last couple of weeks. I think if anything right now, you know, artists and executives alike, we're more empowered to speak our minds and be a bit more transparent with our experiences. I think that with everything that's happened, that's provided us the opportunity. I mean, I think in general, I can't say there's anything specific that I've encountered. And I'm sure the second I'm finished answering this question, I'm going to think of like two or three things.
Yeah, that happens to me too.
But I mean, I think the biggest thing, you know, you encounter, especially being Black in this business, is, you know, trying to move up and you know, seeing your counterparts, you know, advance more quickly than you, even though, you know, you might have more experience or you may have, you know, done a few more things and gotten more stuff under your belt than them. You know, that's always, you know, something that comes up. There's always the idea that, you know, you're not being compensated as much as your counterparts. So, you know, those are things that often come up. And I think to answer the question, it's very, very important that I think everybody speak their minds. I mean, obviously, I think it's also important to say that you have to pick your battles. You know, everything isn't worth the fight. You know, you have to really think of the long-term goal and, you know, what is it that you're ultimately trying to accomplish? You don't want to be the person that picks a fight every time there's an opportunity to pick one. But at the same time, it's very important, especially right now, to speak your mind and be vocal. If it's something that you are passionate about, if it is something that, you know, really speaks to who you are as a person, I think it's really important that everybody feel comfortable, especially in this climate, bring your full self to work, bring your full self to the studio, bring your full self to the stage, whatever that may look like for you. It's extremely critical right now because, you know, unlike any other time before, I don't think that we've had the ear and the attention of a lot of the powers that be like we do right now in this moment. And I think it's incumbent upon all of us that when we are experiencing things that make us uncomfortable, or, you know, we see something that just doesn't really align right with what our goals are, what we're looking to do, that we make a conscious effort to speak up. So I think that is very important.
Awesome. Chameleon?
Okay, can y'all hear me? All right.
Yeah.
For me, as an artist and I'm also on a show called Love & Hip Hop Miami. So like for me, I think my fans, you know, to speak on any political situation or just my mind in general, sometimes my fans look to me for validation to say, okay, yeah, since she said it, it's confirmation. You know what I'm saying? Like he said, especially right now, like my great grandmother, she was one of the first Black women and the last to be executed in the electric chair in the state of Georgia. So, you know, with this whole movement, I've been very, very vocal about it. You know what I'm saying? You know, a lot of people who do have the influence that I have choose not to speak on it. But I feel like for me, I'm for the culture, and everything I do pushes the culture forward. You know what I'm saying? So it's like a person like myself, my opinion is important to certain people. And before I give it, I make sure that I'm saying something, you know, and the way I'm saying it, it makes sense so that a person can still respect it, even if they don't agree with what I'm saying. But
right, that's important. That's very important.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's not what you say a lot of times, it's how you say it. And to be honest, like, I'm still working on that because, you know, the way I was raised is you just say whatever the hell you feel. You know what I'm saying? But it's like being a person that's an influencer, you never want to, you know, you just always have to be conscious of how you say things, you know. But I don't have a problem with speaking my mind. I never did. And I really feel like people appreciate that from a person like myself. So.
Awesome. This is directed towards Portia. And then after this, we're going to ask one more question to go around and then we'll wrap up. Portia, just speaking in terms of talent management, and representing individuals, you know, creative individuals, when it comes time, and I know that a lot of times, you know, even myself and Navita included, are on the talent management side. Oftentimes, a talent runs to us, and they're ready to go crazy on the internet. They're ready to, you know, let the world have it, let the brands have it, and oftentimes we end up being, you know, the psychologist or the psychiatrist that has to sit them on the couch and calm them down and kind of work them through those emotions. Speak on that experience and kind of what it takes to work a talent through the emotion when they're ready to, you know, say for instance, a brand pulls out last minute because of something that they might have saw or, you know, something else happens and, you know, just things don't go their way. Speak on how, you know, important it is with the relationship between talent and rep, you know, to kind of work through those things together, because I think artists need to hear that as well. You know, that is, yeah.
Well, it's funny because I work with a lot of different talent that you guys may or may not be familiar with. K-Camp, I work with K-Camp with Naveed. I also work with like B Simone and Light Skin Keisha and Pretty B, helping them secure sponsorship deals with different entities and brands and things of that nature. And I think the most valuable thing that you can do is have a relationship and great communication skills with the brand. One thing that I'm very particular about is communication. Like, you have to have great communication skills to deal with me, period, because I'm going to be on your head. I'm going to blow your phone up. I'm not trying to get on your nerves, but I'm going to be on your head. It's like, answer me. Like, don't ignore me. Just answer me because I'm trying to get work done. And luckily, even in the midst of some chaos currently I'm dealing with, brands have just been cooperative and understanding, like, listen, these people are still human. I understand you want your brand exposed, but you got to also understand that these are like human beings and they go through different emotions. They go through life situations and things of that nature. So even like, what was that yesterday? I had to talk to a big brand and let them know, like, listen, I just need you to give my client a little bit more time to be able to post your content. And, you know, they were perfectly fine with it. They understood because I have allowed myself to have great communication skills with them and made sure that they understand and respect me and my client at the same time. So luckily, I haven't had a situation where a brand had to pull out from working with one of my clients, but I have had moments where I had to like respect my client in a way of giving them their space and then coming to them in a way of like, hey, if you need more time, just let me know. Like, you know, just trying to be a friend, because these people that I work with are more than just like a client. They're like friends and family to me. So I always try to make sure I respect their space at all times. So at all costs for me. So for me, it's more so about just having that relationship and communicating very well between all entities, from if it's the manager, the client, or the company, just making sure that, you know, they understand that we are all on the same page and understand that my clients are human. So don't be riding their back, you know, like relax, just bear with them, you know, so.
Awesome. Yeah, so as we go to wrap things up, I know we had a few technical difficulties. Thank you guys all for bearing with us. Thank the panelists as well for bearing with the technical difficulties. But just to wrap things up, I think that everyone has and holds a particular unique position when it comes to interacting with artists. And so I would love for everybody just to give a tidbit of insight on what they feel like is like something that an artist just needs, that, you know, that it factor. I know a lot of time people say, yeah, you just need that it factor, but that doesn't really help artists because they don't really know what that is. And I guess some figure it out, some don't. So I guess I'm trying to close the gap on that. And if one thing that you can label as the X factor or the it factor that an artist needs, you know, so we'll start with Navi, just the top, might as well, and then we'll go around.
Man, that's tough. I don't think there's one thing, honestly. I would say treat this business, if you really want to do this, treat this business like a community and take care of each other, support other artists, because you don't know who's going to rise to the top. And I would say to add to that, kind of going with that, like, protect your reputation. Like, you don't want a reputation as someone who's trying to finesse people or taking advantage of somebody. Like, do the right thing, take care of people, and support the community. Because, like I said, you would be surprised at sometimes how quickly things go. Like, I've seen early days being in New York, I met Sheck West when he was living in the projects and had nothing going on. Slept on my couch for 2 months and then signed a huge deal. Or, you know, kids like Masego, same kind of story. You just kind of like, and I, by the way, I don't manage either of those artists. They're both talented guys, both my friends.
But show love.
It's not about closing the deal. Sometimes it is, but it's not always about closing the deal. It's about doing the right thing and being a supportive person. And then, you know, those things come back around. Like, those guys hit you up and they send you business your way, and things kind of like flow and work together. But if you do the right thing, like, your name is your reputation is all you have at the end of the day. So if you protect that, I think your career will always, you know, slowly incline. And I guess just to add to that too, it's like, don't necessarily look for the Hail Mary 60-yard play on every situation. Like, just try to gain 2-3 yards every time down the field. If you do that consistently, and don't try to skip steps, like, you'll be surprised at how fast you grow taking that approach.
Awesome. We'll go with Sarah.
Sure. Yeah, it is a tough question. I guess I can answer from the perspective of talent that excites me, that I really look forward to leaning into the relationship, and that's talent, no matter what size, that are of their word, do what they say, they follow up and follow through. I can't tell you, you know, it's so easy to dream and think of an idea. That's not the hard work. The hard work is execution. So if you say you're going to do something, do it. You know, send the photo, send the video, send the proof. It motivates me to follow through on my promises. I just think staying in touch that way. I don't think there's anything as too much information, like too much sharing. I want to feel part of your process and part of your rise. And when you're in touch like that, I don't think you should, like, everyone, like, kind of speaking to what Naveed said, all talent should consider who they're talking to, whether it's a label or a brand. That's your friend, that's your family. You can text them and keep in touch and share news with them the way you would your fans, because ultimately you're trying to make fans out of these people. And it gives me ideas. Nothing's gonna get done from one conversation. Nothing's gonna get done from one meeting around the conference room. You know what I mean? It takes, let me throw ideas your way. You give me ideas. Let's do some shit together. Did it work? Did it not? Did it fail? And you just, like, keeping people posted on your progress is really motivating. And I promise you, like, from a brand perspective, I've seen people do shit that's really cool. And I've, like, wanted to lean into that and support it, whether it's financially, whether it's with product, or kind of bringing them into the fold, and creating something along those lines with them. So I don't know if that was like 30,000 answers, but
yeah, no, that's all good. That was enough. That was enough. You dropped the gems for us. Portia, next.
I'm a fan of artists that are authentic. They are relatable. I don't want to hear about your million-dollar home that you don't live in. You know, I love people that I can really, like, relate to. Like, you are in the trenches. You're talking about you grew up in the country. You was riding horses. Now you're in a Lamborghini. But this is real life events. These are not things that you made up. Like, I like people that I can, like, go to for humor as if they're my friend. Like, I feel like Cardi B does a great job of that. Like, a lot of people tried to hate her for so long, you know. And one thing about it is you can't deny her authenticity. You know, one thing about her, she's real as they come to me. This is my personal opinion. She real as they come. Like, she gonna make you laugh. She's gonna make you cry. She's gonna tell you about politics. but it's nothing she's like making up. It's nothing that she's trying to pretend to be. So I'm really in tune with artists that are truly themselves. I don't care if you ratchet and everybody's like, you so ratchet, be your ratchet self, because I'll probably come to your page to get your ratchet self. You know what I'm saying? I want that in my life right now. Or if you just, you know, you into blues or jazz or whatever, and I just come to your page for those type of vibes. But I like artists that are true to themselves and don't try to, like, stand out and be somebody that they're not. Because a lot of us know, deep down, if you about their life or if you're not. Or, you know, we know the real you. So I just love artists that are authentic. And I think, to me, that sets a lot of artists apart. And there's a way for a lot of people to work with you, especially when you are, I always tell people, this is a key factor to anybody working with artists. Treat them like regular people. You can't treat artists like celebrities, because when you do, they will treat you like shit most of the time. So for me, I treat them like they're my family. I treat them like they're my friends. And you can always get like the realness out of people. So for me, I like the authenticity of an artist.
Pop. I love all the information that's being shared. I'm gonna use some of the information. But I think I think the biggest thing that I could really like leave an artist with is don't think that you have to like, you know, look like vertically as far as like, you know, building your career, always like trying to like literally like climb the ladder by working with other like companies or other people that are bigger than you, or, you know, that have larger followers than you, or, you know, that type of thing. I think the most important thing that an artist could do is like, you know, control the space that they're currently in. Like the space that you're currently in is going to be the space that you have the most control over, and the space that most importantly people will eventually want to enter if you create that space that, you know, is a dope space. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, a lot of times I feel like, you know, even me looking back at, you know, some of my, you know, things that I've done over my career, you know, I spent a lot of time, you know, basically, you know, trying to like, you know, reach other people who may have, you know, had, you know, similar synergies that I wanted to have for myself, but that at the time, you know, I didn't have the overall like understanding and know-how to basically be able to communicate with them in a way that could benefit both of our relationships. So I feel like, you know, if you're like Naveed was saying, if you are putting that 10,000 hours in and, you know, actually harnessing your craft and harnessing your skills, you know, developing relationships, you know, horizontally around people who are your peers, you know, who have, you know, the same drive and same motivation that you have, you know, as far as just like reaching, you know, new levels with your, you know, music or your brand or whatever it is, you know, that you want to do as far as your artistry or your product or whatever. I think, you know, the most important thing that you could do right now and where you are right now is like really like taking ownership of the space and really like controlling what's in your arm's reach, you know what I'm saying, today. And I feel like if you take care of that every single day, you're gonna like get wherever you wanna, you know, get, because you're controlling that space and you're creating your own, you know, your own reality. And I think, awesome, you know, a lot of times, you know, we look at the Jay-Z's, or we look at, you know what I'm saying, the Migos, we look at all of these different artists or whatever who have made it to a certain level of stature or whatever. But the thing that we don't realize is that, you know, the Tatas, the, you know, all of these different artists that, you know, or, you know, people that are surrounded these major artists, they actually, you know, they met along the journey that they, you know, created as far as, you know, their stardom or whatever. And they, you know, pushed their, you know, they pushed them, the A&Rs or the, you know, the different people who actually, you know, helped create the brand, you know, they pushed them to the level of being the artist that they are, but they were all friends, you know what I'm saying, in the beginning. So, you know, start looking at, you know, your situation as far as that, as where you are right now, you know what I'm saying, you know, in short.
Yeah, absolutely. Mike and then Chameleon to wrap it up.
Yeah, for me, in terms of artists, you know, my thing is always, you know, like, what is your vision and what is your legacy going to be as an artist? Like, that is always, you know, when I'm listening to new music, that's always what I'm thinking about is, you know, is this something I can see myself revisiting in a couple of years from now? Is this something that, you know, I'm 29 now, but when I'm 39, is this something I might want to listen, still go back to and listen to? Like, you know, figure out what your vision is as an artist, because I think a lot of times, especially now with social media, with the internet, things can come and go so fast. Things happen so fast. Things move so quickly. And so, you know, 6 months today, an artist, you know, a 6 month run feels like 2 years just because of how fast things move. But you really, you know, I think artists should really think really long term. Like, don't be short sighted. Like, what is your plan in 3 to 5 years? I'm not saying. And then once you hit 3 to 5 years, okay, cool. What's my plan for the next 5 years? I'm not saying look at the next 15 or 20 years right now, but you do want to like kind of have in your head what that looks like, both artistically and expanding your brand outside of that. That means moving into the entrepreneurship space. That means, you know, stepping into acting or stepping into some other interest that you have. You know, just really think about what your vision is. Don't be short-sighted. Don't just look at it as, all right, well, I saw what XYZ artist did in 8 months. Like, they went from being on their couch to being at the BET Awards in 8 months. I want to do the same thing. Like, the one thing about this industry is that there might be a lot of similar stories, but the one thing about this industry is that everybody, whether you're an executive, an entrepreneur, an artist, everybody's story is unique. There are no two stories in this business that are the same. That's because there's a gazillion ways to get to success. And so you have to figure out for you what that looks like. And the only way for you to figure that out is to really sit down with yourself and think about, you know, to the best of your ability, what you want that picture to look like for yourself. Don't try to copycat the next person, you know, don't force yourself to try and be so unique artistically. It's important to be unique, but be unique to yourself, because the reality is music's been around how many decades at this point. It's very unlikely that some artist is going to come out and they're going to be completely brand new. No one else has ever done what they've done before. That's highly unlikely in 2020. There's been so much coming on. So, you know, focus on being unique to yourself. Don't try so hard to do something that you think no one else has done, because someone else has probably already done it. But however you can be unique to yourself and figure out what that vision is for you as an artist, that's what your focus should be, and then you go from there.
Awesome. And then Chameleon to wrap things up.
Yeah. So I wanted to say, and I mean, I can only really speak from my perspective, but like for me, like I've always been the underdog in coming up and to finally, you know, I still got a ways to go, but finally breaking through as an artist, you know what I'm saying? And as just as a personality as well, like be consistent with what you're doing. You know what I'm saying? Like everybody don't have that it factor, you know what I'm saying? But they got the talent. You feel what I'm saying? So it's like being consistent with whatever content that you're putting out. You know, I started rapping in my car, you know what I'm saying? And gaining my audience that way. So whatever it is that you do, like be consistent in it and invest in yourself. Whatever you want to do, invest in yourself. If you don't have a manager, you don't have a label, whatever hustle you got, like take that, flip that, and invest in yourself. You know what I'm saying? And I feel like telling your story is important, because I feel like fans latch on to who you are, not just the songs. Like the song can fade out, but there are some people that's still making money right now. They never had a hit, or they had a hit and the hit's gone or whatever it is. But like, people attach themselves to people and their stories that are, you know what I'm saying, relatable. And I will also say, like, learn what your audience loves. Like, B. Simone is also a friend of mine. And I remember, you know, both of us, like, coming up, and she was like, yo, I want you to write a song for me. She wanted to do music. And I was like, well, I want to learn how to get my fans up. Like, show me what's important and how to grow my fan base. And like, we exchanged like services, you know what I'm saying? And we grew like that. And she's successful to this day. And I am too. So it's like learning what your audience likes about you and just like expounding on that and really just not caring what people think and what people say about you. Like, just go for that shit. Like, go for it. And if they don't believe now, success make people reinvest. They'll always come back. You know what I'm saying? So all you need is you from the ground just to believe in yourself, and that's all you need.
Drop bombs on it. I appreciate each and every one of you guys for just taking some time out of your busy schedules to impart some wisdom on the artists. No doubt, I know that they're going to all walk away from this with more knowledge and more inspiration to achieve the goals that they have set. Again, thank you to all of the sponsors, from Gold 38 to SOB's NYC to Bag Management Global to Arts and Rhymes. Thank each and every one of our panelists, and thank each and every one of the viewers and artists that are in the chat. And again, guys, for the artists that were selected for the collaboration playlist on Spotify, you should be receiving an email from SOBs letting you know that you've been selected. And I'm wishing you guys all great success, much health, life, and safety as well. For sure,
same,
everybody
you.
Be safe. Thank you again for joining us, and we look forward to speaking to you guys again.
Somebody in my life, man.
Go on with it.
Yo, is it? Are you kidding me?
Okay.
Us, yeah. So we are coming with a force. Yeah. Lessons we are reaping, we course in on. Oh, in a rise and boast. Yeah, we give thanks that we need it the most. We have to give thanks that we really supposed to be thankful. Blessings all for my life. And
yeah, that's right.
4, 3, 2, 1.
You're now tuned into Arts and Rhymes Radio.